Welcome to the video series, The Operational Amplifier, From Abstraction to Reality. This first video is about operational amplifier abstraction. It's an easy systematic approach to design op-amp circuits. It makes use of some simple assumptions about the circuitry operation using the ideal op-amp concept. I'm sure most of you are familiar with the use of this ideal op-amp abstraction, so feel free to skip over these topics. However, if you've been away from this stuff for a while, you may find it to be a useful review. Let's first look at the graphical level of abstraction. Let's take a simple amplifier model of a common source MOSFET amplifier. There is an input port and an output port, and there's also a power port. For the sake of abstraction, we don't care that it's a MOSFET. We can draw it as a triangle with the same ports. Here's an example of a schematic inside the analog device's OP490 and its associated ports. We don't need to be distracted with all that. Here's an example of a bipolar power connection to an op amp. We have the positive DC power and the negative DC power. Also, notice this example is different than the previous because it has a differential input. The differential input provides a direct way to apply negative feedback, which makes the op amp so flexible. Often, it's a single supply. In that case, we just use this simplified symbol. We are going to be drawing these op-amp circuits many times, and with this simplified triangular drawing, we don't need the details of power connections. They are just implied. Even the detailed schematic for real products, op-amps often come in multiple instances within a package. Their power inputs are already connected inside the package. The detailed schematics we'll have the first instance of the op-amp with the power pins, and the other instances are just implied. There are lots of op-amps that run on a single supply, but we will get into that in a later series. The three-terminal graphical abstraction generally implies the single-ended output is referenced to ground. The simple three-terminal abstraction makes it easy for us to analyze op-amp circuits without the distraction of power and ground and the op-amp internal components. We just talked about the graphical abstraction. The other important abstraction is used to perform circuit analysis. These abstract assumptions greatly simplify the circuit analysis. It treats the op-amp like an ideal circuit element in the form of a three-terminal circuit box. Textbooks often use a voltage-controlled voltage source like this one. This abstraction makes it easy to use Kirchhoff's current and voltage laws, Ohm's law, and superposition. Here is a list of the abstract assumptions. It will assume the op-amp has infinite open-loop gain. We know it's not infinite, but it's plenty high enough that the assumption holds. We demonstrated that in the history of the op-amp video. The infinite gain assumption also makes us assume that the differential voltage between the two inputs is zero. We know there is a finite input offset voltage, but the assumption is the voltage offset is zero. This assumes you have a zero output when the differential input voltage is zero. Circuits that require high DC accuracy, like a strain gauge or thermocouple, will require a rigorous analysis that includes the offset voltage. Those applications may have calibration adjustments necessary to account for the input offset. For small AC signal applications, it's not usually a concern. The next assumption is zero bias current. This means the input of the op-amp draws zero current when a voltage is applied to either input, and therefore, the input impedance is assumed to be infinite. This is what allows us to use the simple application of the various circuit analysis laws and theorems to analyze the feedback networks. It is assumed that the output impedance is zero. Although the op amp's output impedance is not zero, the loop drives the output to a level that would be consistent with 0 ohms. For the abstraction, the op amp has infinite small and large signal bandwidth, and therefore infinite slew rate. The last assumption is that the op amp has infinite drive with no voltage rails. That's a definite limitation, but knowing the input level and gain, it can be known how close to clipping the output is. As a takeaway, every op amp abstraction assumption is a lie. Every designer must make the assessment of what can be assumed versus doing a more rigorous detailed analysis. We just mentioned the voltage rails, so it's a good time to take a look at something that's quite obvious but worth including. Let's plot the input voltage versus the output voltage of the amplifier open loop. The positive supply rail is plus 15 volts, and the negative supply rail is minus 15 volts. Here's the response shape. The point at which it clips the rail is the saturation region, and in between is the active region. Let's say we put in plus 10 microvolts DC and assume the gain is exactly 1,000,000. The output will be 10 volts. Here are some important takeaways in this subject. The open loop gain varies widely from device to device over temperature, aging, and mood swings, to name a few. The only feasible open loop application I know of is a voltage comparator, and you generally use a real comparator IC when a comparator is needed instead of an op amp. The op amp needs negative feedback to control its gain. Some of the op amp's outputs are rail to rail, and some are not, so the input will not go all the way to the rail as shown in this plot. Let's look at the abstraction that the voltage between inputs is zero. Our model says that the output voltage, VO, is the difference between the two input voltages times the gain, A. Rearranging that to solve for the difference in input voltages places the gain A as the divisor. We make the assumption that gain A is infinite and this term goes to zero. This mathematically makes the difference between the two input voltages zero. Therefore, V plus equals V minus. This is often called the V plus equals V minus method for analyzing op amp circuits. It's one of the key assumptions that makes this abstraction concept work so easy for us. The first application for the op amp we cover will be the inverting amplifier. Here's the circuit diagram of an inverting amplifier. The input signal, VI, is applied across resistor R1 to the inverting op amp inverting input signal. Resistor RF is the feedback resistor, which connects from the output to the inverting input. Following the concept of abstraction, there is no current flowing into the inputs. The circuit is called an inverting amplifier because its voltage gain is negative. That means that if the input voltage is increasing or going positive, the output voltage will be decreasing or going negative, and vice versa. The non-inverting input to the op amp is not used in the inverting amplifier circuit. The figure shows the V plus input grounded so that the V plus terminal is 0 volts. Even though the V minus input is not grounded, it is said to be a virtual ground because the voltage is forced to zero from the infinite gain assumption. When negative feedback is used in an op amp circuit, the output will do whatever it can to force the voltage at the V minus input to be equal to the voltage at the V plus input. I sub I is the current in resistor R1. IF is the current in the resistor RF. Since no current flows into the input, the current flows through R1 and RF. Since a positive VI input results in a negative VO, I sub I equals negative I sub F, the V minus input is forced to 0 volts. So the sum of the currents into the V minus node through resistors R1 and RF must be 0. Let's represent these currents with their voltage over resistance. We can write I sub I as VI over R1, and also write IF as V sub O over RF. We then rearrange to express the gain as V sub O over V sub N. It equals minus RF over R1. This is the simple formula to select the resistor values for the gain you want. Since the non-inverting input is virtual ground, the right side of R1 is at 0 volts, and therefore the input resistance RI equals R1, because the other side of R1 is at virtual ground. Using the abstraction rules, the output impedance R sub O is 0 ohms. A voltage-controlled voltage source model is often presented showing the input resistance as R1 and the output voltage as minus RF over R1 times the input voltage. Next is the non-inverting amplifier. Here's the circuit diagram. The input voltage VI is applied directly to the non-inverting op-amp input. A voltage divider, consisting of resistors RF and RR, connects from the output node to the inverting input. I call it RR as in return resistor, but you will see it sometimes as RG for R ground. Once again, this assumption is there is no input current. The circuit is called a non-inverting amplifier because it has voltage gain that is positive. That means if the input voltage is increasing or going positive, the output voltage will also be increasing and going positive. Using the abstraction that there is 0 volts difference between the inputs because of the infinite gain assumption, we can write the equation for VI as a voltage divider between the output and the inverting input. We rearrange the terms of gain, which is VO over VI. I'm highlighting this expression because in later examples, it will become more meaningful and useful. To get the standard textbook equation for the gain, we eliminate the duplicate R sub R term by multiplying 1 over R sub R in the numerator and denominator. That gives us the gain as 1 plus RF over RR. Since the input voltage goes into the non-inverting terminal and nothing else, the input current is 0, and therefore the input impedance is infinite. And of course, the assumption is that the output impedance is 0 ohms. The voltage-controlled voltage source model is often presented, showing the input resistance is infinite and the output voltage is 1 plus RF over RR times the input voltage. Moving on now to the voltage follower application. The voltage follower is also referred to as a unity gain buffer or a unity gain non-inverting amplifier. Watch how this compares to the non-inverting amplifier we just looked at. Resistor R sub R is omitted and the feedback resistor RF is replaced by a short circuit. Because the output node is connected directly to the inverting input instead of through a voltage divider, the circuit is said to have 100% feedback. Because V plus equals V minus, it follows that VO equals VI. Also, if you remember from the history of the op-amp video, we calculated closed loop gain as a function of the feedback factor beta. Beta for the follower is 1, so the closed loop gain is 1 and follows the math. Therefore, the circuit has unity voltage gain. The voltage follower is often used to isolate a low resistance load from a high resistance source. That is, the voltage follower supplies the current to drive the load while drawing no current from the input circuit. Here's a source connected to a load using a voltage follower. The source resistance is 10 kilo ohms and the load resistance is 100 ohms. There is no current in the source resistance, so the voltage at the op-amp input is Vs. The output of the op amp can be sized adequately to drive the 100 ohm load. If we remove the follower, it's just a voltage divider. That divides the source voltage by 101. That's a decrease in output of 40.1 dB. In the case of the inverting amplifier, where the high gain is needed, resistor selection becomes problematic. Per the equation for the inverting amplifier gain, if high gain is required, either the RF must be large or R1 must be small, or both. A large feedback resistor is a problem since it will create an additional pole with the parasitic capacitance of the inverting input, which can cause instability. If R1 gets small, the input resistance may be too low to meet the specifications. To fix this problem, we can make use of the inverting amplifier with a T-network feedback. It can be used to obtain a high gain without a small value for R1 or a very large value for the feedback resistor. We can use the Thevenin theorem to replace R2, R3, and R4 with a single resistor and a voltage source. If you recall how that works, the Thevenin voltage is the open circuit voltage at the output here at point A, which is the voltage divider R3 and R4 sourced by VO. To find the Thevenin resistance looking back through A with the voltage source replaced by a short circuit, which is R2 plus the parallel combination of R3 and R4. The gain relative to the Thevenin voltage follows the inverting op-amp formula R feedback, which in this case is R Thevenin, over the input resistor R1. Substituting the V Thevenin and the R Thevenin equations from above here, and finally, rearranging to solve for the gain expression V out over V in. Now it's time to simplify this expression. And solve for R4. Let's put this to work and see how we can make a high gain amplifier with reasonable sized resistors. Let's go for a gain of minus 100, an input resistance of 20 kiloohms, and set R2 and R3 to 50 kiloohms. That gives us R4 as 1316 ohms. Next, in part 2, we will look at more op-amp circuits using these abstraction concepts.